to begin our journey into excitement, discussion, solutions. The methodology in this group would be very informal. We're not interested in titles. We're interested in people stating their points short, brief, and to this and straightforward. We're not here to criticize one another. We're here to find solutions. Since this is a farmer's led field, we farmers are very practical people. Feel free, feel part of the family. We like chaos, but we like solution. If you come up with a critique, come up with a solution also. All the presentation would be short. Everyone here would be classified as a catalyst. In each of the participants would be merged the student and the teacher. So feel free. We are not here as student or teacher. We are all merged into one. We will begin shortly with the presentation, but before I do that, I want to ask each person around the table, since we are trying to create a family atmosphere, just to say your name briefly and which organization you're from. Can the support people please hold the mics and take them to the tables? Starting briefly.
Hello, my name is Wilma.
Hello, my name is Nikki Pirania. I am a dairy farmer from India.
Hello, my name is Michelle Kovacevic and I work with the Young Professionals for Agricultural Development, or YPAD, as an interim coordinator.
Hello, my name is Fumani Mangani. I'm here in my own personal capacity, working with my aunt and well, she liaises for stakeholders and researchers.
Hello, my name is Fatina Olan. I represent YPAD and International Associations of Students in Agriculture.
And my name is Dennis Rangi. I work for the Center for Agriculture and Biosciences International, CABI, based in Nairobi.
I'm Joseph Nethu. I work for the Association for Strengthening Agricultural Research in Eastern and Central Africa.
I'm Agnes Mwamunge. I work for University of Nairobi, but I'm also here as a consortium board member for the CGIAR.
Morning, my name is Robin Guruchara. I work for the International Center for Tropical Agriculture, SIAT. I'm based in Nairobi.
Good morning, my name is Yana Birvoshikova. I work for Biochem Company, which is like the producer of fertilizers.
Hello, good morning. My name is Yemi Akimbami, the Executive Director of the Forum for Agricultural Research in Africa, based in Accra, Ghana.
My name is Charity Kruger. I'm with the FARA.
Good morning. I'm Wole Fatumbi. I also work for FARA.
Morning. My name is Michael Brown. I work for Natives Way Cooperative Fiji Limited. We provide quarantine service to the exporters and growers for exports. I represent IFORM, Pacific Island Farmers Group. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sirka Imanen. I work for the CGIAR's independent evaluation arrangement. I'm here with some colleagues because we are starting an evaluation of partnerships. Also one of the best development. We have decided that at 6 o'clock in the occasion room.
Hello, my name is Mariam Georgiadze. I come from Georgia. From Biological Farming Association of Ghana, working with organic and small matter farmers.
Hello, my name is Manshu. I'm a farmer from Kazakhstan.
Hello, my name is Doran Daba. I'm a business woman involved in agriculture. I'm also a board member of the Agricultural Research Council in Pretoria. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Sylvia Nakunda. I work with YPAD. I'm the country representative for Uganda, but I also own a business in yogurt processing, cottage industry.
My name is Johnny from Ethiopia. I'm from a private company, Episa Business Services.
Hello,
I am a good economist at ICRIS at Malawi.
Good morning, I'm Samuel Akhamo. I'm the small stock farmer, Namibia.
Good morning, my name is Robert Kipaya. I work with Chikandwa Community Development Organization and Youth in Technology and for Development Uganda.
I am Mike Shorten. I'm a strategy consultant to the Agricultural Research Council. I'm helping them in looking at what agriculture is likely to be in 2050 and how they need to respond.
Hello, good morning. My name is Kellyanne Alicott. I'm from Barbados. I'm here representing the Youth Wanted Program organizers, ambassadors for the Youth Entrepreneurship Incubator Program in Barbados. I'm also one of the YAP finalists, one of the 6 YAP finalists. I'm also a seed facilitator, which is Student Empowerment Entrepreneurship Development in Barbados as well.
My name is Philippe Bernier. I'm from CIRA, the Public Research Organization, and I'm based in Montpellier, France.
My name is Olivia. I work for the Agricultural Research Council in South Africa. I'm a smallholder agriculture developer.
My name is Calvin Miller. Recently retired from FAO, where I was leading agribusiness and finance work. Now an independent consultant and part-time small farmer.
Hello, my name is Wango Mwangi. I'm with IIST, the
Committee. Good morning, my name is Faith, and I'm with African Forum for Agriculture Advisory Services.
Hello, I'm Beatrice Singina. I'm from Uganda. I work with the Consortium for Enhancing the Ambassador's Possibilities to Agribusiness Development. It falls under the Farrer's Uni Brain Program. I'm happy that the ED is here.
Good morning. My name is Emmanuel Athlet. I'm from Tanzania, and I'm working with Tanzania Water Partnership and the Eco Living Association. And currently, I'm responsible now to prepare a framework on how to engage smallholder farmers. Because we have acquired 800 acres at the Rufiji floodplain, and we want to engage in a project of poultry and fish farming, because it's an opportunity that those kind of production is not existing in that floodplain. Most of the farmers are engaging on crop production, so we want to shift it from crop production to that kind of business. So the framework we want to try to look at how the smallholder farmers now can engage in agribusiness using the framework of tangible goals approach. So I think this kind of meeting is the key for me, and we welcome different partners and investors to invest on that kind of plan. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Biso Maruma from Botswana. I am a farmer.
Good afternoon. My name is Kevin Mafuleka, and I'm a farmer.
Good afternoon, my name is Lola Sokoto, and I'm a farmer.
Good morning, my name is Pamela Thomas. I'm from Antigua and Barbuda. I'm also a farmer, and I'm one of the regional directors for CAFAN, Caribbean Farmers Network, and I'm also a co-chair for this morning session. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Nadine Mahwe from Botswana. I'm a co-founder of Brasnorn Enterprises. We bring mobile technologies into agriculture, and I'm also co-chair for this session this morning.
Okay, and my name is Jethro Green, chief coordinator for the Caribbean Farmers Network and chairman of this thematic hearing. We are 15 minutes behind time, so we have two presentations before lunch, and we were supposed to have group work before lunch. What I may do is that we'll have the two presentations, and then we'll have a general discussion to lead us into lunch. And then after lunch, we will start group discussion and the other presentations. So if, like I say, we are going to try to catch up on time and try to make the most of this, but we definitely need your input. So, now that we have gotten the introduction out of the way, Let me start with the first brief presentation in which I'm supposed to talk about clustering of and grouping of farmers with counties of scale. There's a slide presentation, but my pointers might not relate to the slides, but they still have some nice pictures that you might like to see of some of the farmers in our country. So I'll ask them to roll. The first point that I would like to put to this body is that we in the agriculture organizations and the farmers organization see farmers as part of the private sector. And there need to be some current classification, different classification, because we are not really NGOs, because farmers bring to the table lands and skill. And the purpose of clustering or grouping them or creating groups of economies of scale is to make sure that those lands and skills are put into productive use to create wealth and sustain wealth for the farmers. So therefore, we must begin to see the farmers as part of the private sector. Normally, when you go to most of these the organizations, they classify farmers as different from the private sector. And basically, if you look at it, you will see that they are part of the private sector based on what the information I just passed on. I call our approach progressive clustering of small farmers. And because we do the clustering of small farmers mainly to gain production edge, labor edge, marketing edge, and trading edge. What we have discovered in our practical approach to clustering of farmers, and everything I'm telling you is things that we have tested in the field, is that when you cluster, if you cluster, say, 20 farmers or 10 farmers with 2 acres, their output that we have seen is like 2.5 times that of one person with a single unit. And in fact, what we have found is that by clustering the farmers into economies of scale, we were able to make negotiations with markets to be able to say we can make consistent supply of quality and quantity over a period of time. But our approach is different from the traditional approach because we do not believe in forcing farmers into groups. What we do, we create an enabling environment for them to work together. And over a period of time, they will determine the level of organization that they need. For instance, you would find that in our constitution for the Caribbean Farmers Network, in which we technically represent over 500,000 small farmers, most of them under the age of, the acreage is under 5. You would find that in our constitution it says a group of farmers can become a member of the Caribbean Farmers Network, whether they are registered or unregistered, as long as they have a committee of management and have demonstrated that they are working together collectively. Because you find that some farmers work together to provide labor cluster to supplement some of the labor shortages that they have in their area. Other work together to bulk purchase input. Other work together in terms of doing collective action to be able to sustain market. Another area that we have started to work on, which we find very useful, is that in the clustering methodology, the extension service and the technical agencies are now using our clusters as training, as a method of training by grouping farmers together using on a specific farm. You may find that, let's say, in week one, they will go to farmer X in the cluster, and all the training would be done at that farm, and all the farmers come to that farm. It not only creates a sense of family, but it also creates a better understanding with the researcher, because the researcher in our approach are being taught to treat the farmer as equal in the research process. So we are developing an approach which is seeing a greater sense of togetherness and partnership between farmers and the resource organization. And the reason why our focus is on small farmers and reuse clustering methodology, because technically people say, oh, you have a number of small farmers by themselves, they're not viable. Maybe so. But when you cluster them together, their output is tremendous. And there's also another social reason for this. We have found that in areas that we have worked successfully to create sustainable markets, sustainable, profitable markets for farmers, and where you're fine because of the link to market, the profitable links to market, you have seen a less rural urban migration. The other thing that we, why we are so particularly interested and work so fiercely on the question of small farmers and small farm families, is that most of us, after the post-colonial time in the Caribbean, we encourage our government to work to take large tracts of land that was owned by the colonial masters and put up into small farms. And the reason for that, there's an ideological reason for that, is that if you have a number of people in the country that are just simple workers, and you have a few people just owning all the lands, they're not happy citizens. If you have people own a stake in the country, no matter how small it is, and especially if you can make sure that that's a little stake they own in the country, create the kind of environment that it can be profitable and sustainable, then you have very good citizens. The point is, if you allow a situation to develop where your poverty level, whether in the rural or urban area, continue to decline, you're going to have citizens so disgruntled that they have nothing to lose. And you could put all the police and everything you want in place, it's not going to help. The fundamental way of attacking poverty, we believe, is starting at the level of the poor. And it is sometimes very difficult for people to understand that. But a lot of the answers to attacking that poverty is within the innovation and the indigenous knowledge that exists. And so that is what we are bringing to the table to mesh with research. In concluding, let me see, and I don't know if my colleague Pamela would want to say something in about 2 minutes. 75% of the world food supply is provided by small farmers, and there's a reason for that. Although they are resource poor, according to stats, there are over 500 million small farmers. If we target small farm development, not only is there a positive social implication, but in terms of sustained food production and in terms of increased food stability, there's not a question that one will begin to see the improvement. But we must move to the point where we must understand that farmers are business persons. And except we move to the point where they can see profitable, sustained markets, their children are not going to be interested in farming. No matter how much you talk about youth in agriculture, from our research, from our consultation, there's a simple thing that they're saying. We're not in this for our good looks. We're in this to make money. And as long as we can make money from it, we're going to go into it. There are some stories I can tell you about young people going into agriculture. Because of the profitability, you might not want to put on the table here. But the question is, and the issue is, we must ensure that when we are dealing with agriculture, we don't treat it as a side product. We treat it as a business. If we can get even 50 million of the 500 resource poor farmers to be successful business persons, think about the social, positive social and political implication for third world countries. Thank you very much for listening. And now I go over to Pamela. You want to say anything briefly? No. Okay. So that is my presentation for this subject matter. I would now call on my second presenter, Wally. And after that, we would create a plenary discussion for input.
Thank you very much, Green, and distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I will be presenting, I'll be talking about the achieving economics of scale in the African smallholder system through the innovation platform. I made an assumption here that a handful of stakeholders in this audience, we have some knowledge of the innovation platform. And because I have very little time, I will not be going into the details of that. But I want all of us to see a balanced picture of the entire thing in Africa. And then you need to understand that we are talking about the smallholder system. We have all the words I put in here. I don't have a pointer. All the words I put in here, they are very relevant to the smallholder system. We know that there is the problem here is small productivity. Smallholders use crude implements. There is poor returns. There is low labor advantage. There is low is a low external input system. There is poor market access. Mechanization is difficult. There is good. There is land fragmentation issue. The system is still entirely piece and that subsystem. And it's the livelihood, the smallholder livelihood is likely unsustainable. And that is till date. We have a desired change at the back of our mind. We want the smallholder system to be competitive in terms of price and quality. We want the smallholder system to use very good science. We want the system to be profitable in the medium to large scale. We want it to be competitive. We want to even professionalize farming. I'm not talking about professionalizing agriculture, but farming, the field component, we want to professionalize it. We want the system to be mechanized, because this is our perception of the way to make smallholder system profitable and sustainable. And I began to think of pathways, look into literatures and the things we have done over time. I discovered that we need to organize practical linkages between research and generation of the generation of results for the users. We need to think strongly about the policy. We need to invest strongly into research. Maybe when I talk about policy for what? Policy to transform the peasant into small and medium scale enterprise. Policy for land tenure so that we can free up land for agricultural use. Policy to moderate external finance and to strengthen institutions that are involved in agriculture. The issue of mechanization also is prominent. The issue of affordable financing is prominent. But more importantly, as most people have mentioned this morning, that we need to transform the smallholders to small and medium scale business. Now, when we're looking at this with the same perspective for economics of scale, I choose to put this, it's the economics graphical illustration of economics of scale. At the point where I label as red, that is where you get economy of scale. Then after some time, you begin to find constant return to scale. And immediately after that, you begin to find this economy of scale. The more you increase, the less return you get. So the economy of scale is actually the cost advantage that you get when you begin to increase output of products. So it is the inverse relationship between the quantity produced and the unit cost for this. Now, this is the conventional thought when you talk about economy of scale. Everyone thinks that you need to just expand holdings and increase holdings to get economies of scale. But in good theory, you can actually get economies of scale also by reducing the variable cost. If you find a way to improve operational efficiencies, you can get economies of scale without necessarily expanding the scope. When you take good advantage of the technologies, it could be biological, it could be mechanical, then you can achieve the same return as expanding the land. Then when you think about synergies and established linkages, you can actually achieve the same returns you get when you expand holdings. And this is what Farah has been working on in the last 12 years. You will agree with me that in Africa, It is actually very, very difficult. In fact, land issues is the most difficult issues that is battling the growth of our agriculture. I mean, land tenure is a cocky thing. It is really, really very difficult to start talking about expanding holdings for the smallholder farmers. It's a continent where between 60 to 70% of the inhabitants are involved in agriculture. And then there is a lot of fragmentation of holdings, possibly in other continents. And then South Africa is an exception, though, in Africa. But in most countries, you will see that a smallholder farmer is having maybe between 0.2 hectares to 0.5 hectares. Hardly will you find farmers that have 2 hectares up to 5 hectares. In fact, if you have 5 hectares in Africa, you are a large-scale farmer. And so think carefully of the returns you are getting, even from 5 hectares. In countries like Brazil, a 5 hectare holder is a very, very small-scale farmer. And so in Africa, we need to think of a different way of achieving scale. And in the last 12 years, Farah has been working on a method to achieve this. Well, the innovation platform is very prominent in the thoughts of agricultural thinking. Farah developed the IR4D concept, and the operational frame for the IR4D concept is the innovation platform. Simply, the innovation platform is a multi-stakeholder forum. It could be physical, it could be virtual. But what we're talking about is bringing stakeholders that are drawn along the commodity value chain together to interact. When they interact, they jointly identify problems, they jointly source solutions, implement the solution, and benefit from the implementation of the solutions. And afterward, they learn lessons. They keep doing this in cycles until they generate innovations that benefit all these stakeholders. Now, I want to put this on to just show the dimension of interactions that take place on the innovation platform. Essentially, the innovation platform looks at research and development as a fused continuum. And so the technology generation gamut, you find it in the innovation platform. And you find the benefit gamut. But more importantly is the intermediate process that translates technologies into benefit for the end user. I'll move on quickly. Now, when we set up innovation platform in Africa, the innovation platform we simultaneously address research and development as a fused continuum. And so the segregation of having research and development as a separate thing is not there. Every research output will come up with a trade-off, okay? When you have research output and you use it appropriately, we expect development. And when you have development, you have trade-off. The trade-off essentially leads to new research subject, and it goes on and goes on like that. Then when we set up an innovation platform, the way it works, all stakeholders on the platform, we have a contribution. And then they have a benefit to gain by contributing. I mean, you understand that the question always is, what is the need for me? Even the farmers, the youths that are getting into agriculture, they keep asking the question, what is the need for me? So innovation platform provides. Then when you are on an innovation platform, the innovations that are generated must give benefits to you as a stakeholder. The beautiful thing around this innovation platform also is that it engages policymakers at different levels to contribute to the issues on the innovation platform. And it demands investment from all partners. Now, innovation platform also ensures that the public and the private sector, they get into partnership. And so the innovation platform is essentially not saying that we are doing research or we are doing development only. We are doing both research and development, but in a commercial mode. And so when technologies are generated, we are already thinking of who is buying the product that comes out of this technology and how is this technology becoming money in the pocket of the farmers, especially the small older farmers. So that thought pervades innovation platform operations from the beginning. Now, I don't want to spend so much time on this, but knowledge that is generated that is used is what gets transformed in an innovation platform to benefits. And so research teams come in. But within the research teams also are this complementary process, thinking of appropriate partnership, thinking of the producers, thinking of the transporters, researchers, and other relevant stakeholders. It is their interaction. When they interact at the interface of their interaction, they generate benefits. Now, let me get into the economies of scale thought. economics of scale happens in two dimensions on an innovation platform. There could be the internal economy of scale that takes place, and this is just to reduce cost and increase production at the end of the day. And there is the external economies of scale, and these are factors that come from outside the innovation platform. Now, on the innovation platform, specialization is fostered. Farmers are producing on the field. They concentrate on their job to produce. The researchers concentrate on picking problems from the farmers and generating technology, leveraging the technology for users. Extension plays its roles. The private sector plays its roles. So there is specialization. You can actually foster economies of scale by ensuring specialization. If everybody is doing everything, then you remain at the same level, you don't get it. Then on an innovation platform also, there is the mechanisms that leads to reduction in input cost, because you engage an input dealer on the innovation platform, who is looking at how much input do we need to actually service the business model that we have on this innovation platform. And when it's having a captive audience, the cost per unit comes down. We have an experience of this on more than 60 innovation platforms that have been established through the Sub-Saharan Africa Challenge Program in Africa. Then best technologies are leveraged. Machineries are also leveraged for use on the innovation platform. Then on the innovation platform, you have these organization techniques.
Wrap up in 1 minute, please.
What? One?
Yeah.
Okay, then there is this continuous learning on the innovation platform. Well, the factors that are external and that lead to economies of scale is revolve around the issues of infrastructural development and the engagement of the policymaker that provide enabling policies, trade policies, and the market-related policies. Then we have functional institutions and the continuous learning. Those are actually external. Well, this process is improving. This process has been proven and it's been documented. But from the proof of concept, I'd like to just show you the type of results that we got. Just 3 slides and I will close. This concept, does it work? Does it work? Does it deliver benefits? I mean, from 54,000 households across the continent where we implemented this, we discovered that the income of the participating farmer actually increased from the baseline of 1.61 to 3.7 a day on the innovation platform. Then, does the innovation platform actually deliver more benefit than the conventional approach? Income of women on the platform increased by 362%, food security level increased by 324%, wealth distribution, we calculated this using the wealth distribution increased by 5%. Household income increased by 232%. Then income inequalities also decreased by 6%. Then productive assets, access to productive assets also increased within the household. Well, the issue is this actually sustainable? Can you use it everywhere? Can you scale it across? We use economic surplus model to do this estimation. And as at year 2010, we discovered that the innovation platform has actually reached excess of 10 million stakeholders in Africa. Another assessment is going on, and at the end of the year, we will be able to tell the number of stakeholders that we have reached between 2010 and 2015, in addition to this. Well, we have documented the success story of this in this material, and you can get it there. I want to say that the concept of innovation platform is increasing across the continent, and many countries are using it. It is getting institutionalized. Let me conclude in the next half minute by saying that, well, getting economies of scale for the smallholders is really, really very vital if we give it a global view to the development of Africa agriculture, because it speaks to competitiveness. Once your product is not competitive, the end user will rather import from other parts of the country where they get it cheaper. And so this is. Then expansion of farm holdings are not realizable in Africa in the short run. we need to address our mind to that. And so if we want to provide solution, we need to look at what we can do in the short run, in the medium run, and in the long run. Now, increasing farm output will reduce costs is achievable with the use of best technology and smart institutional arrangement. And the use of IR for the concept, using the ID, has provided a useful framework for achieving economies of scale in the smallholder system. So, achieving economies of scale through the large commercial farm holdings, as we see in the West, well, is also possible in Africa. But that must come with supportive land tenure policies and huge investment, which may not come in the short run, but in the long run. Thank you for listening to me. And the chair, apologies for spending more time.
All right, thank you very much. Very good information and very good thoughts. Now, let us open the floor for discussion. Like I say, because of the shortage of time, I will delay the group work until the table work until after, but please feel free to make your input into this. The key point is that what the discussion on the table is saying, in of the find innovative ways of clustering small farmers to gain economies of scale, and like was mentioned by the last speaker, bringing facts to the front, but in the case of us in the Caribbean, what we simply did also was to try to get greater efficiency in the value chain, and by ensuring the training and getting farmers properly trained and clustering and walking and packing and simply doing simple things with their products to reduce post-harvest loss, we have seen prices of 200% goes to farmers without increasing the price to the consumer. So what I'm saying is that they are very simple, innovative ways of clustering farmers to gain economies of scale and to gain them sustainable market and sustainable profit. As we'll see. So let me open the floor for discussion and comment for the next 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, one, table, one, two, three.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Latoya Lewis. I am a value chain manager with the Ministry of Agriculture in Jamaica, sorry. However, I'm here in the capacity as a social reporter. We do a lot of clustering in Jamaica. We have agroparks, and then we're also doing clustering according to commodities, etc. One of the risks associated with clustering is the issue of group dynamics. So I'd like you to delve a little bit into group dynamics. Then the other thing is that we have a lot of farmers who have been traditionally, they've been working on their smallholder farms, and they don't view agriculture as a business. We view them as a business. We view their operation as a potential business, but they do not view themselves as business people. So what comments can you make as it relates to rebranding, as it relates to farmers viewing themselves as a business? And the last point is that we have a lot of farmers, and one of the factors that can affect even their economies of scale and their labor and their costs are the low levels of skills pertaining to their farm workers. What you find is that many of the programs that international organizations do is more so focused on the farmer and not so much the farm worker. And getting and having those transferable skills from the farmer to the farm worker, what comments can you make in terms of us improving that? Sorry for being long.
Okay, I will take all the questions and then I will answer and you will make some input. And then other people could make input. And these are good questions for the table discussion. Eh?
Okay, well, it can also be answered anytime.
No, but we'll make some comments. Okay, let me take the others. Comments or questions, yes?
Okay, thank you very much. Again, my name is Yemi. And I want to briefly reflect on the two discussions that have been given. Excellently well done. The session topic is on sustaining farming as a business. And listening to the clustering philosophy from the Latin and Caribbean region, and what obtains here in Africa as presented by my colleague Wale a short while ago. For me, I think the question that is begging an answer is one niche higher than what modalities are we using? To produce enough food for our populations, I think we need to be very clear in our minds what we need to generate, first and foremost, the biomass of food that is required. And the second thing will be the non-biological part of it, how to make money out of it and to make the business attractive. Now, if I take a quick example of what obtains in Africa, this morning we heard from the young folks telling us that the average age in farming is anywhere, it's actually above 60. And why is that so? The way we practice agriculture on this continent is largely, what is going on the fad is, when I'm approaching retirement, then pension planning people come and they encourage me to go into farming when my back is now stiff and my hands can't move. So the farmers are, people think that the logical thing to do, farming is the business to retire into, and that is totally wrong. And what we need to do as professionals within the GCAD philosophy is to change that mentality. Farming cannot be what you do when you retire. And we must find ways and means to entice the young folks. And in doing that, science has a great potential. And that's why for us in Africa, I think you can hear more about it, and I want to seize this opportunity to invite you folks to Far Outside event at 6 p.m. tonight. We'll be talking about the science agenda for agriculture in Africa. Okay, so I think I have to stop that.
Yes, thank you very much. Very good input. And then over there.
It's also on the clustering presentation. My name is Joseph Methu from Azareka, Association for Strengthening Agricultural Research in Eastern and Central Africa. The benefits that you outlined, Jethro, are real, of course. By clustering, you achieve economies of scale and so on. But what you didn't say is how, because you said your initiatives are about supporting the farmers to loosely work together. But you didn't tell us how loose that looseness is, because it has a lot of bearing. If it's too loose, you have a problem. And leaving it loose is like encouraging, you know, first of all, you said you again want to promote farmers as players in private sector. So you are like, by leaving it too loose, you are actually encouraging a very fragmented private sector that will not even benefit from the economies of scale that you are aiming for. So my advice is that you need to go beyond a loose working together to some kind of formal association of the farmers. And when I say formal, it means they need to have some legal status as a group if you want to really work, let them work as a vibrant private sector. Whether it's a legal association, it's a company, it's a cooperative, but let them have a legal status, because after that, by doing that, you make them play by some rules that they agree upon to work together with. They have a voice for lobbying if they have a loose, if they are formal. Of course, if they are loose, then they don't have that voice. And they cannot be exploited, because they now can, they have a muscle to go to court, they have a muscle to, you know, use the law, the legal mechanisms in their respective countries. So that's the point I wanted to make.
All right, let I make a brief comment on this, and then you make a brief comment before we take a second round of question. First of all, I understand what you're saying, but a lot of things is different. One of the biggest problems I've seen throughout most of the developed countries is that when donors come in with funding, 12 farmers, they say farmer group. And they form these organizations. And they don't last as long as Ms. Jane, in fact. They don't last long. All right? Because of the fact that it was created. What we do in the organization, and this has worked in all the new groups that have come up in the CAFA network, are even more successful than the older group. You create an enabling environment for people to work together. It takes longer, but they maintain and determine their own destiny. It is not created by outsider. It is not created by the government. It is not created by donors' pressure. And what we have found is that some of the clusters have gone into sharing labor. Some have emerged, like in the case of Antigua, into where they have a national cluster, now deal with young people, etc. But it was never, we would never go into a situation and say form a group. We would grid and create a series of discussions about the benefit of working together, and the people would choose what area that they want to work together. I'll tell you what, because each individual within the cluster is a business person, and all you're offering them is an avenue to join together to make their individual business more successful. By lumping people, like what the politicians have done over the years, by lumping them into clusters, national, cooperative, etc., I would tell you, and this is from my experience, I've spent so many years in this, it does not work. It's better that the people determine their own situation. And when they do that, you bet you that it is sustainable. Somebody talk about group dynamics. What we do also within the organization is that we create, when we go in to discuss with clusters of farmers, what we try to show them is we approach it with regards to team leadership. It is in most of the organizations that have failed throughout the world is where you have the same one man, one woman leadership over and over again, and there's not a space created for group leadership. Within the CAFA network, it is a team leadership. And the way how we do this is that if you have a group of people within your organization and you have a leader, whatever the leader knows or whatever the leaders do, everybody must be part of. Because one of the things that we know as human beings, you're naturally flawed as a leader, because today we are sick, today we have a tragedy in our family, we can exercise leadership. But if it is a team approach, it does not affect the implementation of leadership. And it's a new methodology we have been practicing, and what we have seen emerging with the new groups that is coming out, in which the operation is like a family, as opposed to where you had this competition of fighting for leadership, like in the politics and the trade unions. We don't have that. We create an environment where people work together, and they determine their own destiny. It sounds very strange, but what we have seen, that it works, and it is more sustainable. Now, what you're saying in terms of the legal terms, I don't disagree with you, because in the long run, if they emerge into like legal entity, they could go further and go into bank loans and all these kinds of things, and even more formal arrangement. But they must determine that themselves at their own time and their own pace. And in the end, when we are in a day, sustainable is their stuff. You want to raise any points?
May I say also, because you
want to say something else? She just wanted to
say
something.
Okay.
I just wanted to, in relation to what the gentleman said there, in each of the countries, even though
Mike.
The term loan is mentioned, each country is still responsible.
Yeah, this is working.
Within each country, we are responsible for the direction in which our group goes. For instance, in Antigua and Barbuda, our CAFAN group, we are a registered cooperative, so we are a legally registered entity. In other countries as well, you have one group forming a company, one group forming a cooperative, so we do have that sort of legal entity that you mentioned, but that is determined on the ground by the national cluster, not handed down from head office.
No, the boss have said that we are almost at time out. So let's wrap up in 10 minutes. Oh, you have to give us 10 minutes. Yeah. 5 minutes.
Okay.
All right. 5 minutes.
Okay, let me quickly.
Right. 2 minutes and then 1 point for another minute and then we go.
Okay, all right. Let me respond to these three questions in order.
In 3 minutes.
Well, I agree with you that the group dynamics can actually be a constraint. But our experience showed that almost all the innovation platforms set up today that are functional today, they went through the forming, the storming, the numbing, the performing, and many of them are at the stage of transforming. I mean, except they are not human beings. And this is peculiar for innovation platform because you're not just bringing farmers together, you are bringing all manner of stakeholders. And you are bringing stakeholders even from outside the rural community. You're bringing researchers, the extension agent, the private sector, the impute dealer, the policy, so that the entire chain is complete. The manufacturer, even the end user in some of the innovation platforms. So the group dynamics thing comes in. But you know, on an innovation platform, the role of the facilitator is actually key to the success. If you can manage it very well, then you get very good success. Let me talk about the loose arrangement.
2 minutes and then we'll pick up your thing. After lunch, you have the mic.
The issues of the loose arrangement is also very vital. Our own experience showed that the more the formality, the more stable the innovation systems approach, the more stable the success of the innovation platform. I mean, the situation may differ from one continent to the other, but in Africa, I think people don't just want to lose things because it is business. Businessmen don't get into things that they cannot trust. Something, they want a document. The minimum you find on a functional innovation platform is a memorandum of understanding that Mr. James is a feed miller. He is buying 300,000 tons that is produced by farmers on this innovation platform, and they do an MOU. Then the farmers now and the researchers now begin to think of the technology required and all those things. Otherwise, things will fail. Thank you.
So in wrapping up, let us remember that we bring experiences from all across the world. Africa would have its own dynamics, Caribbean would have its own dynamics. By looking at the different dynamics and practice across the world, because some things that work in other countries, they now work in other countries because of sociocultural factors. So bring the broad experience, and that is what is going to enrich this.